Maybe I'm Casey, maybe I'm Casey, maybe I'm not.
All right, Jane Slater is joining us. NFL Network reporter. She is in Dallas right now, which is the center of panic in the NFL. I actually picked the Cowboys to go to the Super Bowl, partly because I want them to go to the Super Bowl because Fox has a Super Bowl and I'm a selfish company woman. But I also think that they have a very talented team, and they just lost to the winless Jets, to Sam Darnold coming off the kissing sickness. And everyone's freaking out. So what's the mood around the Cowboys right now?
The one thing that I'll say about the Cowboys is, regardless of what's going on, Dak Prescott seems to always have this sense of self. In other words, I've never seen the guy outwardly panic. And if you talk to his teammates, they say that's the one thing that really galvanized them their rookie season. Here was this fourth round pick who was the fourth guy on the roster. I always remind people, Jamil Shower, the guy who ended up playing defense, was the third string quarterback behind Tony Romo and Kellen Moore. That just seemingly stepped into the role and was able to inspire this feeling in Dallas that in the past with Tony Romo, and people forget this, you know, history's always kinder to people. The knock on Romo was that he would find ways to lose at the end of games. Dak is a guy that, and you've seen him come out, you know, regardless of the deficit in the third quarter. I mean, he was perfect in his third quarter comebacks until, I believe it was 2 weeks ago. He was able to just come out and galvanize the team, and when he would talk to the players, he would find ways to at least make you think you could pull off the game. And in a lot of cases, we've seen this fourth quarter comeback, he was able to get it done. I still think that they're going to benefit from that, Joy. But I think the problem is when you start looking at some of these injuries, they're beginning to pile up. And when I was out there doing the show with you guys and I talked about this team, I was like you. I thought sky was the limit. This was one of the most talented rosters the Cowboys had put together in years. Everyone was focused on the need for Ezekiel Elliott. And we talked about finally creating so much depth in some of these positions. But when I'm looking at a guy like Amari Cooper, who is dealing with not only quad and ankle injuries, now he's got this, you know, this thigh quad contusion. Doesn't look like he's going to be able to go against the Eagles. You look at Randall Cobb, he's still dealing with some back tightness. We'll see how he is. Tyron Smith has been breaking down in recent years. And so now you've got a guy who's, we don't know if that ankle is going to be an issue. He's apparently being evaluated on a daily basis. They're hoping he can practice at some point this week. Then you've got Lel Collins, their other offensive tackle. And then, oh, by the way, not just one, but two cornerbacks, Byron Jones and Anthony Brown out. You've got your defensive end, Dorrance Armstrong, who's dealing with a stinger. And then you've got Tyron Crawford that just now went on season-ending surgery. He's going on the IR because he's got a hip injury that they're going to have to now deal with. So, I mean, we're talking about significant loss of starters. They ended that game against the Jets without six. I'd like to say that this is a team that we look at San Francisco and Seattle that's able to overcome a lot of these injuries, but we're talking significant injuries to significant starters.
Yeah, it's really, when you talk about all the injuries and you're listing them, it's sounding a little bit like the Chiefs, because everyone's panicking about the Chiefs right now. And it's kind of like, when it comes to the Chiefs, everyone's like, well, you know, they're having some struggles, but it's just injuries. Where when it comes to the Cowboys, it's like, yeah, they have some injuries, but they also still have, like, Dak's just not ready, and Dak's just not the guy. And I appreciate you saying that about Romo as well, because, you know, you're right. And I've said that about Romo for a long time, and I always get pushback from Romo lovers, but that's just the truth. Like, I feel like Dak is a more clutch quarterback, whatever you want to do with clutchness, but he has had them come back in these games that they've lost, and they've showed, like, some heart and fight. So it's not like they just got blown out and laid down, but all of those injuries are playing a major role. I also think that they're having a real issue with the running game. So what's the issue with Zeke? Is it just the offensive line?
You know, I think the offensive line is an issue. I think some of it is, you know, teams have figured out his game a little bit. But I think the curious thing is, you know, we were looking at all of this pre-snap motion, the creativity from Kellen Moore in the first three games, and that's where all of us said, that's what we were seeing at camp. That's what we've been telling you guys about. That is, you know, this is a different offense. It looks better than Scott Linehan's. Kellen Moore is the innovator. He's the answer to Sean McVay's Sean McVay, and then now all of a sudden they're looking vanilla again. Now, again, I think the argument that I've gotten when I've talked to a bunch of these guys was, of course we had to run the ball because Dak is getting killed out there. It was very similar to, if you'll remember, when Chaz Green was in that Atlanta game. One of the, if you Google it, it's like one of my favorite, not my favorite images, because people aren't going to like when I say that, but one of the more, I thought, interesting images, and one that will always be burned in my mind, was someone had done a, it was a graph of every way that Dak had been sacked by Atlanta, with Chaz Green in the game, and it looked like something from like Dante's Inferno. Like, that's how bad it was. He's getting killed back there now. They do have depth and that offensive line. Maybe they'll be able to gel with another week. We did see that they would slowly, you know, when they lost guys like Travis Frederick and Tyron Smith and Zach Martin in the past, it would take them about a week or two to sort of get into a groove. And, you know, I do have faith in guys like Cameron Fleming, and, you know, they've got the one guy that hasn't, that we haven't seen anything from, is the rookie that they went and got, the kid out of Penn State. We haven't seen him this year. But it is going to be interesting to see if they're going to be able to get this thing together, because I'm looking at the schedule, Joy, and this is where this is concerning. When we were talking about Zeke not being a part of this team, a lot of people thought, well, Zeke's going to have to come back in week 7 if he wants this season to count. And, you know, the Cowboys are going to be able to get through the first half of this schedule. Giants, Redskins, Dolphins, you know, Saints might be tough. Packers might be tough. They'll get past the Jets. And then, you know, we'll see how they do against the Eagles when they have a bye. Now let's look at the schedule after the bye week, after the Eagles.
Right.
They're at the New York Giants, which, okay, they don't have Saquon Barkley and they don't have a lot of their key players, but I think they're going to look a little bit different than they did when they saw him with Eli Manning. Then you've got the Vikings here. Then they're at the Lions, at the Patriots, and this is where this thing gets ugly. This is murder's row. Starting November 12th, week 12, they're at the Patriots, then they've got the Bills here for a Thanksgiving game, then they go to Chicago on December 5th for a night cold game. Then you've got the Rams here, then they're at the Eagles and Philly, and then they've got the Redskins on the 29th. So I think this thing's going to get tricky for them. You know, I think it's, the health is going to be an issue. They're going to need some depth back. I will say that, you know, keep in mind last year, they were 3-4, I believe it was, before the bye. They made all those changes during the bye week. They fired their offensive line coach. They made a trade for Amari Cooper, and then they ended up becoming the NFC champs. I think the NFC is going to be a little bit easier for them when you consider the Giants, the Redskins, Philly. But when you look at the NFC in general, this is tricky for them this year. And as, like I said, especially when you consider the schedule, this is the first year in franchise history where they don't have back-to-back home games. They're on the road every other week.
Yeah, the schedule is definitely brutal. And it's funny that you mentioned that Chaz Green game. I will never forget that ever. It was staggering to watch. And I'm sure that I haven't seen that graphic, but I'm sure it perfectly encapsulates how everyone felt that Chaz Green game. I felt like Dak should have been paid at the beginning of the season. I fully believe that Dak deserves all of the money, and he should get all of the money, because despite whatever struggles they're having now, he's had tremendous success with them, and he's always compared to Carson Wentz for multiple reasons, but he's, in my opinion, it's not even my opinion, he's had a more successful career so far than Carson Wentz. Carson Wentz got paid. I don't understand what the issue is with Dak, but the way that the season is going, do you think that it's going to affect Dak's contract situation?
Well, everyone decided to, specifically his agent, Todd France, came out and absolutely denied that his camp was asking for $40 million. And I continue to stand by that report. That was the initial ask, no different than when Ezekiel Elliott went to the Cowboys, and I was told his initial ask was somewhere around the $19 million range. It's a starting point. The goal was obviously to get the Cowboys to somewhere like $35 million. There's no question that the Cowboys don't want to start over. They believe Dak's their guy. He's the face of the franchise. And I went to the University of Texas, and I always describe it this way. Not just anybody can go be the head coach of the University of Texas, for the same reason not just anybody can be the quarterback for the Dallas Cowboys. You're sort of like pitch man, politician, / player or coach, depending on what scenario we're going to apply this to. A guy like Dak Prescott, who toes the company line, is the perfect pitch guy. You should see him work a room. He's everything the Cowboys want. He's not getting into trouble off the field. You know, he's a leader in the locker room. He's the guy that's taking them on, you know, team bonding trips in the off season to develop chemistry with his receivers, et cetera. He's everything you want. But I would argue that if he had gotten this contract done before camp, I think he would have been in the $33, $34 million range. Depending on how this season goes, I feel like he's going to lose a little leverage.
Yeah, I mean, I think he's definitely losing leverage too. And again, I don't get too crazy about the number because the number is the number. Like, once the market is set, that's what he's going to be paid as a franchise quarterback. People freak out about how much these guys are paid. Like, it's next man up, and the next guy's going to get more money, and that's just how it works. So it's a little different than, you know, say baseball or even the NBA, which has, you know, more of a soft salary cap. There's always going to be a limit, but at the end of the day, he's your quarterback, and they're not getting a new quarterback. So to me, the argument about whether, like, to move off of Dak, it's like, just stop. You sound silly. That said, there is a serious conversation about Jason Garrett. Now, I don't think that Jason Garrett is Andy Reid or Bill Belichick or Pete Carroll, but he's fine. And I'm very against firing coaches in the middle of the season. I think it sends a terrible message around the league. I think it completely demolishes your season and your locker room. And it's a bad look all around. It doesn't help anyone. Like, just let them finish the season, fire them with grace, move on. You're not moving on to a new coach in the middle of the season. You're not, like, getting ahead of the coaching search. And it's the Dallas Cowboys. Now, I don't believe Jason Garrett will be fired midseason. I don't know if you agree.
I agree.
I just think it's nonsense to even have that conversation. It's not going to happen. But is he there next season? If they say they don't make the playoffs, is he there next season?
Well, and look, I think it's valuable for us to walk your listeners through why you might believe that and why I believe it. And I'll tell you why I believe. They gave him a one-year deal for a reason. They didn't give him a six-month deal. They gave him a one-year deal so they could, in good faith, say, Jason, we gave you another season. We also gave you everything that you wanted. In other words, if you wanted Kellen Moore to be your offensive, you know, to your quarterback's coach last year, we gave it to you. Then we made this change, and he is your, you know, offensive coordinator. Although I would submit that that wasn't all J.C. Garrett. That was Jerry Jones. But they've given him pieces along the way and autonomy, and for the most part, they stepped off and said, Jason, this is your team. We're going to support you publicly. Show us what you can do. When I've talked to them privately, and I'm talking Stephen Jones, I'm talking Jerry Jones, the feeling I always get following our conversations on that very issue, because we've had seasons like this with Jason Garrett pop up in the past, it's sort of this, they feel comfortable with the devil that they know. And Jerry was on 105.3 The Fan here. You know, he and Stephen Jones talk on The Fan, the local radio sports talk show, once, twice a week. And it was last week that Jerry Jones said, I wouldn't make a wager if I were you. In other words, wager against Jason Garrett that he would get fired.
Right.
I wouldn't put a wager on that. And then today, I thought he had a lot of interesting things to say. He said he's involved into what I think is a top-notch coach. He would be sought after if he was on the open market, and I believe that. Justine Anderson, I actually, like, had a Twitter battle over this last year. Because she submitted that there wouldn't be teams that would be interested. And my argument back was, so you're telling me teams like the Cincinnati Bengals or Arizona, if things don't turn around, or Miami, go down the list. If Jason Garrett is out there on the open market, you don't think one of those teams could come after him? He's only had one losing season the whole time he's been in Dallas.
No, he would absolutely get hired.
That would be completely okay with that. And I would also argue that the reason why he remains in Dallas, and Jerry hinted on this today, there is a discipline about him. There is a way that he goes about things. There's a continuity about him. And I'm trying to find the quote to give it to you best. But he literally said what I've been arguing to people for so long. In other words, he's never lost the locker room. It always seems like no matter what, these guys continue to play for him. Here's what he said. He said, we all need a certain order and discipline. He creates that. You can't separate that from the coach and the person. He's a top-notch individual who happens to be a good coach. He wouldn't be our coach for 10 years if he didn't have a lot of qualities to coach. And then he also said, if I totally agreed with Garrett's philosophy, he wouldn't be the head coach. And I believe that. And I believe that because, again, I think it goes back to Jerry sees these guys buy in. Like, if you're looking for – this locker room is so uniquely finally his. I mean, there were guys in the past that, you know, they'd go and they'd say crazy things to the media and they were emotional, et cetera. These guys now, like, you're not going to get them to say much. Like, you're not getting guys that are saying – you don't, if you've noticed, there's not a lot of leaks that come out of that locker room from players. There's just not.
Yeah.
And I believe that's because they are protecting and buying into Jason Garrett. Now, do I believe that they feel like he's the best guy to run this offense, et cetera, things along those lines? Not necessarily. I've talked to former players that absolutely are not a fan of the way that he calls plays, go down the list. But in terms of being the head coach, saying the right things, inspiring the team to that there's a process, to buy into that process, to do things the right way, to be men of character. Those are all the things that Jerry and Steven like about him, and that's why he's continued to stay in Dallas. And he's also never tried to go out there and undercut the Jones family. There's not really an ego that comes with Jason Garrett, and they've dealt with ego at head coach in the past.
Yeah, and that's very important in Dallas. But I like that. The devil you know is better than the devil you don't. But thanks so much for joining us, Jane. I really appreciate it. You are an expert and excellent, and we love watching you on NFL Network, and we love when you are in town and you come on the shows, especially on The Herd.
Thank you so much for having me on, Joy, anytime.
Okay, thanks, Jane.